Let's look at another example of modeling a problem using linear programming, again to do with production. So recall that a linear program is an optimization problem where you have some variables which describe the quantities you want to compute, and you now have linear constraints on these variables as well as a linear function describing what it is that you want to optimize, maximize or minimize. That's called the objective function. And one way to solve a linear program is to think of it geometrically and use the simplex algorithm. And the simplex algorithm exploits the fact that the optimum value of a linear program is always at the vertex of the feasible region. So it starts at some vertex and it keeps going from one vertex to a neighbor until it finds a vertex whose value is optimum with respect to its neighbors. And the claim is that that vertex actually represents a solution. We also said that we can justify that this is the optimum value by constructing the dual, which asks how to combine the constraints together to minimize the combination. And a solution which solves both the original and the dual is actually an optimum value. So the next example we are going to look at is a carpet manufacturing company. So we have a company which makes hand-woven carpets, and we currently employ 30 employees. Each employee produces 20 carpets a month and is paid 20,000 rupees a salary. So if we just look at the cost per carpet, then we are paying 1,000 rupees to manufacture each carpet. Now it turns out that our monthly demand is seasonal. So after looking at some past data, we have made an estimate of the amount of carpets that we can expect to sell in each month of the year. So we have a range of demand from 440 to 920. So remember that if I have 30 employees and 20 carpets each, I can make 600 carpets in a given month. Okay, this is what I can do with my current staff. Now sometimes the demand is as low as 440. So if I make 600 carpets, now if I have 30 employees and each one is going to produce 20 carpets a month, I'm going to get that done, right? So I'm paying a person to make carpets, not to sit idle. So every employee will produce 20 carpets a month. Therefore, I will always produce 600 carpets, but I'll have 160 perhaps, which I can't sell that month. But there are some months where I would have a demand for 320, and now it's a question of whether I have enough carpets to sell or not. So I know the demand from January to December, and say these are stored as D1 for January, D2 for February, and so on, to D12 for December. So I have these 12 quantities which are known in advance. These are how many carpets I can expect to sell in each of these months. So now I have to come up with a strategy to cope with this varying demand in order to make sure that I lose the least amount of money because of this demand fluctuation. So one possibility is that whenever I have extra demand, okay, I pay overtime. So if I pay overtime, I get workers to work longer hours and make more carpets. But there are two costs to this. The working wage per hour for overtime is typically higher than the regular wage. So let's assume it's 80% extra. So if you remember, originally we paid 1,000 rupees per carpet as our labor cost. So if I make it in overtime, it's going to cost me instead rupees 1,800 per carpet, because it's going to take the same amount of time and the person is going to be paid 80% more. So 80% of 1,000 is 800. So it's going to cost 1,800 per carpet is the overtime rate. The other thing is that you cannot, of course, expect somebody to work 24 hours a day. So there is a limit saying that a worker cannot make more than 30%, cannot spend more than 30% overtime. So if they make 20 per month normally, then at most they can go plus 6. Right? A single worker can make at most now, including overtime, 26 per month. The other option for me is to add or subtract employees. I might want to add new workers in case I have a higher demand projected that month. Or I might need to terminate some employees in case my demand drops below 600. But this also comes with a cost, okay, because I have to do some paperwork and also I have to give some compensation and so on. So let's assume that there are some certain costs. 3,200 is the cost associated with hiring a worker, and 4,000 rupees is the cost associated with firing a worker. And finally, I can store carpets when I have made excess and sell them later when I have a demand, but storage also costs something. So let's assume that storing a carpet costs rupees 80 per month, because I have to keep it carefully, avoid damage from moisture and all this. Right? So these are the various options. I can pay overtime, but up to a limit, and it costs more for a carpet made by a person who's being paid overtime. I can either add or subtract from my workforce, but this also comes with a cost each time I do it. And finally, I have a surplus storage cost in case I want to keep my production handed over from 1 month to the next. So we want to make a linear program out of this. So we need some variables. Right? So we are dealing with these 12 months, January, February to December. So it's natural to think of everything as happening within the scope of 1 month. So for month I, where I ranges from 1 to 12, let's assume that we have WI workers. Initially, we have 30 workers. Right? Then from these 30, we will either hire or fire some to get the workers in January. Then we will hire or fire some to get in February and so on. So each month, potentially, we have more or less workers, but we start with 30. Now, these 30 workers will make some number of carpets. So let's assume that the total number of carpets made in a month is XI. And OI, which is included in XI in terms of the total, but OI is specifically the number of carpets which are made in overtime, because for these, there is an extra cost. Okay? This is over and above the salary we already pay the worker. And finally, we said that we have this hiring and firing cost. So let HI be the number of workers hired at the beginning of a month, and FI be the number of workers fired at the beginning of a month. And let SI stand for the number of surplus carpets that I have in stock at the end of month I. So I initially assume that I have an empty warehouse. So S0 is 0, but S1 will say at the end of January, how many carpets am I storing? S2 will say at the end of February, how many carpets am I storing, and so on. Right? So there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 quantities. Each of these quantities is there for 12 months. So I have 72 variables. Plus I have these default initial variables for W0 and S0. So I have 74 variables. Okay? So this is a lot of things that I have to estimate. But it turns out that actually in a linear program, this is not a large number and it can be solved quite efficiently by any of the standard things, including simplex. So let's now think of the constraints. So the first constraint is the usual one, which is that every quantity that we are talking about is strictly greater than or equal to 0. The second constraint talks about how the number of carpets made break up into the regular production plus the overtime. So if I make I carpets in a month, then each worker, remember WI is the number of workers in my establishment in month I, will make 20. Right? So 20 times WI is what workers in month I produce in the normal time. And in addition to that, OI is just the number of carpets made. So OI is not the number of hours overtime. So OI is the number of carpets. Right? So each month I make 20 times the number of workers plus OI. Now, if I had WI-1 workers last month, and I hired a few and I fired a few, then the total number I have now is the old number plus the number I've hired plus minus number I've fired. Okay? So this is a constraint on how each of the WIs is connected to the previous WI. Similarly, the stock is connected to how much I had before I started this month, how much I made this month, and how much I sold. So remember that D1 to D12 was the demand. So this is a fixed quantity. These are not variables, these are known values. So in this month I would have sold DI, but I produced XI. So XI minus DI is the excess that I produced this month, or the deficit as the case may be. I started with a surplus of SI minus 1. So if I add this month's surplus or deficit, I get the total surplus at the end of the month. Okay? And remember, I can't have negative carpet. So SI, all these things must always be bigger than or equal to 0. And finally, as we said before, a worker who produces 20 carpets in a regular month, if I add now the fact that he can do 30% overtime, okay, this is 20 plus 6, right? So the number of carpets made in overtime can be at most 6 per worker. Right? So OI should be less than or equal to 6 times WI. Right? So these are our constraints now. So now, given these constraints, what we want to do is minimize the total amount of cost that we are going to put out. So first, this is the regular salary cost. Okay, so the regular salary cost is 20,000 per worker. And we have W1 workers in month 1, W2 in month 2, and W12 in month 12. So we add up the total number of workers. Each of them is paid 20,000 rupees. So this is our total salary bill for the year. Then, depending on how many people we hire in each month, for each hire we pay 3,000. So this is our hiring bill. Similarly, for each person that we dismiss, we have to pay 4,000 first. That, so this is our firing bill. Then the number of carpets that we have to keep in storage in each month incurs an 80 rupees per carpet cost. So I have to multiply the total storage by 80. And finally, when I pay overtime, I am paying over and above the salary. So each carpet made in overtime, remember, costs 1800 rupees as opposed to 1000 rupees which is already accounted for in the salary. So this is my overtime cost. So now, so this says that we can take this fairly complicated looking question about production with demand and hiring and firing and productivity and all that, and set it up with some 72 plus 2, 74 variables and a complex cost function, and feed it to simplex and get an answer. So we run simplex and we find the solution. So are we done? So it turns out that we might get an answer which is not something that we can actually use. For instance, we might get an answer which says H3 is equal to 10.6. Okay, so this tells us that we must hire a fractional number of people in a month. Now obviously we cannot do this. At the same time, we have not in any of our constraints expressed that the values must be integers. So what can we do about this? Well, we can take this 10.6 and we can look for the nearest integer 10 or 11 and re-evaluate what happens to the cost if we make it to an integer. This is called integer rounding. Now, if the values are big, you know, they're like 10, 11, if they're two-digit values, say, then rounding is a relatively small displacement and the quality of the optimum will not change much based on this. But if the numbers are small, if I'm rounding between, say, I'm going to take it from 0.5 to 1 or 0, or from 1.5 to 2 or 1, then the effect of that rounding can be quite drastic, right? So this is a general problem with linear programming, which is linear programming cannot guarantee you that you have integer solutions when you want an integer solution. You can use rounding to achieve an integer solution, but you have to be careful that the rounding actually gives you an optimum. Now, why not just insist that you want an integer solution? So can you not set up the same problem and solve it, but require the solutions to be integers? Unfortunately, this turns out to be quite a hard problem, right? So we have claimed that when we set up general linear programming problems, we can solve them efficiently. So simplex is not an efficient solution, but an effective solution. But there are interior point methods and other polynomial time algorithms for linear programming. But if you change the rules of the game and say, I don't want an arbitrary solution that meets the constraints, but I want one where all the values that I get are integers, then we have the so-called integer linear programming problem. And integer linear programming, unfortunately, is not solvable efficiently, or at least not known to be solvable efficiently. So the best we can hope to do for integer linear programming is to actually try to turn it into an arbitrary linear program and somehow interpret the answers as integers by doing appropriate rounding.